All right. Good afternoon, everybody. How are you guys doing? You enjoying MACNA so far? Yeah? That sounds very enthusiastic. Really? Come on. All right. My name is Jeff. I'm the president of the San Diego Marine Aquarium Society. We're the club that's hosting it this year. So I wanted to thank you guys for coming. We really appreciate it. And it is my great honor to introduce this year's MACNA Aquarist of the Year, Joe Yaiullo.
Well, huge thank you to Jeff and his crew for taking on this challenge of hosting MACNA and helping out tremendously with me and my family and getting my boys here. So gonna go through some slides pretty quickly, and I think I'll hold the questions till the end. And I'm here all weekend, so also if you have questions during the weekend, feel free, please, to approach and talk. I never get tired of talking about corals. If you bring a beer with you, you might get a little more information. But basically what we're going to talk about is the principles of diligent reef keeping. Is it old tank syndrome, or do your corals simply suffer from LARS? We're going to discuss what LARS is, and we're going to discuss what old tank syndrome is, OTS. But just for some perspective, I wanted to show you where the Long Island Aquarium is. I'm the curator and co-founder of Long Island Aquarium in Riverhead, New York. It's about an hour and a half outside of New York City. It's a full-blown aquarium. It has sharks and stingrays and sea lions and seals and penguins and all kinds of good things. So it's not just a coral tank there. I like to do a lot of other things besides corals, but corals do take up a great deal of my life. And this is a good part of it. It's kind of a little bit older picture there in the middle, but this is what they grow into. There's no delaying that. And I'm now shorter than two of my sons, so it's kind of sad. And Dan and I are just about the same. So life continues, life changes, and everything is really cool, and life is good. But we're going to get into discussion of LARS. So this will have some audio at one point.
Well, my reef tank is failing. I think it might be old tank syndrome. Just don't know if there's anything I could do about it. I mean, not that long ago, I was tank of the month, man.
And you wanted him here with you?
Yes.
For support?
Definitely, yeah.
And how long have you had this tank?
6 or 7 years, closer to 7.
How big is it?
It's a 220 with a 50-gallon sump.
Sure. How are your nitrates?
Good.
Define good.
Well, the water's clear.
So is vodka. Clean your pumps? Protein skimmer?
The protein skimmer broke about 2 years ago, but nothing in the tank changed, so I just left it off.
Hmm. Wow. Okay, how are your phosphates?
Between 2 and 3 parts per million. Well, hey, Richard Ross, Aquarist of the Year, said his are above 3, so I think I'm okay.
Yeah, I don't think he was actually recommending that. What's your pH run?
Around 8.
And you calibrate regularly?
Yep.
You change your probes?
Well, they're not broken. Greg Biggerman said they last pretty much forever, so...
Okay, Craig Bingman, and he would never say that.
What?
Do you change your light bulbs?
Well, they still come on. Sanjay said...
Nah! Please. Bit of a name dropper there, aren't you? Hey, you know, actually, would you mind just showing me your system?
I don't think I can do that. It's a little too soon for me. But I'm sure he would love to show you my stuff, yeah.
Thank you. What is it? OTS? Is it old tank syndrome?
Well...
Oh, God, I knew it was!
No. It actually looks more like your tank is suffering from LARS.
LARS? What's that?
Well, it's an acronym.
Oh, and man, that sounds bad. Is that a parasite?
No. It stands for lazy ass reefer syndrome.
Oh. Yeah. What can I do about that?
Well, a number of things. Start changing your water, for one. Get a hold of Bob Stark over at ESV. But first things first, you're gonna have to get off your ass.
So, thank you to my boys for that. Yeah, we all suffer from LARS. LARS is a thing. It happens. And I think it kind of dismisses old tank syndrome. So we're just going to talk about how to avoid old tank syndrome, which is a syndrome that doesn't exist, and how to help avoid LARS, and being diligent with your reef keeping. So it starts with planning ahead. So you can avoid a lot of problems down the line. If you do start ahead with some plans early on, you can see some of the early architects that I brought in with me there when we were planning the aquarium. So this is how my public aquarium that I founded started, on a couple of sheets of paper. And there's a great story behind all of that. But it's 16 years old now. To get the job done, many child labor laws were simply ignored to get the job done on time. Like I said, we have a bunch of great animals at the aquarium besides corals, and there's a very happy young man with some baby penguins. So the building of the reef tank started with 30,000 pounds of quarried limestone from the Midwest, and it was stacked to provide the reef structure. And you can see there's lots of spaces and gaps and things for water flow, very important, independent of tank size, for water flow. And again, by doing your rock work properly in the beginning, avoids problems later on. So this is the tank with the initial rock work still going in. Like I said, about 30,000 pounds of quarried limestone. And problems, we all have them. No matter what, there's always going to be problems, and it's what you do with those problems that lets you keep moving forward. Again, you can bring in the big experts here, and working through those problems is better than a restart. Too many times people run into a situation, they break their tank down, they're going to reset it. A lot of times, just work through it, get it to where you want it to be, you'll end up with a better and stronger tank. Reading books, right? Books are great. Remember those things with pages, and you turn them? So this is Julian and Charles's book that came out in 94, and I still reference it today. And some of their books are better than others, and it's, you know, what you want to do with those books. Surely I Jest, this is an incredible series of books. Dirk probably is out there and has some copies. What I love here is Merlin is actually looking right at Julian and Charles, who are on the photo there. So. Power outages and long-term damage from those things can stress out your tank. And again, we're looking to keep our tanks good long-term. So get a generator. There's people out here that will spend $1,000 on a coral that I need a jeweler's loop to see what they just bought. But to get them to spend $200 on a generator, no. So just get a generator. This is me sitting at 2 a.m. Because I have a generator at the aquarium, and I can just relax. Again, staying ahead and keeping things going. If you have a major coral loss that you're happening, you can either pull some of the corals out and use 10 milligrams per gallon doxycycline. I have done whole tank treatments also with doxycycline. I'm not recommending just shotgun approaches with throwing antibiotics at stuff. That's not it at all. But if you really think everything is going to go, then resort to some doxycycline. We could kill sound on this one, please. So this is just a recent, quick, really rough video of the tank where it's at right now, just filmed this past week. There's also a fair amount of frozen copepods and P.E. calinus in the tank right now, and it's a really great food. So I've been changing my theme of my tank, and it's 16 years old. So the fish populations have changed, been pretty dynamic, and I'm now getting back into getting rid of the bigger fish and getting back into a lot of my smaller fish and anthias and wrasses. So it's been fun over the last 2 years renegotiating the fish populations in there. So part of that is also, again, for long-term success of the tank. The tank is 30 feet long. It's 14 feet front to back, about 6.5 feet deep, so a little over 20,000 gallons. And I'm not sure how many fish now, so but it's increased dramatically in the last 2 months or so, and I'm really, really enjoying it. So the beginning of the tank, again, here's the west side. You know you have a big tank when you have an east side and west side of your tank. So that's the same zip code, but east and west side. Again, so there's 30,000 pounds of quarried limestone rock in there with 10,000 pounds of live rock skin put over that. And this is the west side, which was more branch rock. This is the system a year later. We're at the initial corals. You can see some new little coral acros and frags implanted in there. Here's the tank in 2009. That's the same. So even in, you would think 20,000 gallons, you don't have to really worry about pruning and things, but you do. And again, this is all towards keeping the tank successful long term. Here's a little closer shot of the acropores and things. Those are the Stuber acropores, and there's a whole story there. But they all started from little 1 and 2 inch fragments in the system. And you can see it's just getting overwhelmingly crowded. There's less water flow. So going in, diving in the tank, going in and pruning. So pruning back from here to here, take a look, see in the tank. Okay, didn't get the effect I was completely looking for. Went back in, pruned it back down again. So it's a never-ending chess match. That's how you can view reef tanks. To get to the point in the industry, compared to when I first started back in the mid-80s reef keeping, that we'll actually be just crushing up some of our coral skeletons that we grew and putting them back in the calcium reactor. Like if you had told me that when we first started this, because when I first started reef keeping, it was almost shortly after when SPS, especially acropores, were considered impossible to keep in captivity. So everything that you guys see today, and even within the last 5-10 years, none of that existed. So there's a great history there. So no audio on this also, please. So I got my lovely assistant there. So I do scuba dive in the tank. I have a tank with a long regulator hose on it, so it's more of a careful walk within the system, which is pretty cool. It's my job. And I get paid to dive in a reef tank. We don't get rich as a marine biologist, but I think it's pretty cool. So I'm just going to talk about looking at some of the tank. What happened here was one of the big acropores had fallen over. They've gotten so large that they collapse under their own weight, which is a means of natural propagation in the wild. But again, just trying to stay ahead of, and excuse the blue lines on the windows. That was for buffing out the acrylics. So that they're not normally there. But here's one of the acropores that fell over, even though it had a lot of points of attachment. And it was right near Sanjay's acropore too, so I'm sure he woke up in the middle of the night when felt it. Because that's his. So you do say a prayer. You just gotta try and figure out what to do. So there's some clownfish there that you see, and it's near their anemone. So you can see just even with many points of contact. So a lot of times we plant an acropora as a single branch and let it branch up, and now it's hanging on one base going up. So even though I had grafted a whole bunch of corals in here, the thing still fell over. So kind of crazy when you're talking about like that's a frag, like that's a. And what do you do with frags? I don't know. I'm going to throw it over here for right now, and I'll get back to that. So there's no way I'm going to be able to replant this coral back to where it was, and I'm near the clownfish and anemones home there, and they weren't too happy about me being there, and they're going to let me know about it shortly. They think it's their tank, so they're coming in. You know, thank God they don't grow as large as sharks, because you would never go in the water. So I'm throwing jabs, and they're biting my knees, they just don't care. They just, So that's a good part of it. So I think maybe in the urgency of time, well, we'll see, the video will speed up here a little bit. So just thinking about like that started as a Yes, as they and it was. I laughed through my regulator because as I went to pick up that coral, I'm like, okay, lift with your knees so you don't throw out your back. I'm like, no, this is really getting obscene that I have to worry about throwing my back out. And there's Laura's creative Latin name for the wrasses that love to follow me around when I'm doing my work, making sure I'm staying on top of things because they do want it good. But he's my bud. They follow me around. They love disturbances so they can pull out their, get to their little copepods and things like that. But I think I may go through this. So, okay, I'm going to continue through. So yeah, getting that whole thing replanted was quite the thing. So I just put back a few smaller branches and let it grow again. So this is going to the east side now. You can see the quarried limestone base with the initial live rock. Here it is a year later. And here it is in 2012. So fish populations and things. So here's that stand of yellow turbinaria there. And that was always kind of one of my pride and joys. I wanted this huge monospecific stand like you'd see on a reef. So I let that grow in, but it grew too large actually after many years. And it was growing very tall, it was very forward, and it was far to the left. You couldn't see corals past it. And I want the tank to look a certain way, and my eye starts twitching when it's not looking the way I want it, and I have to get in there and deal with it. And it took me a couple of weeks of mental deliberations to decide, okay, I need to go in and modify this section of tank that's really never been touched. So here it is, after doing one long dive and excavating underneath, getting rid of some of the rock work, getting rid of some of the old dead coral skeletons underneath it, and you can start seeing some of the corals behind it, and it's allowing the tank to look bigger again because it's not in your face right at the glass. It's opening up the tank again. And this is something, again, that goes towards that long-term survival of your tank because you have these huge monster walls going up with your corals. That's decreasing the water flow. That's decreasing everything. It's accumulating detritus. And these are all things that are going to knock down your tank over time. So what worked in the first few years, and you get cocky and arrogant, won't work in subsequent years because your flow is diminished and everything else. So this is going back in the second dive. So hammer and chisel to try and break some of this stuff apart. And again, the fish love when I get into situations like this. This piece of coral is even much heavier. And Julian did a great, he took a photo from this segment or a different segment, because it looks like, if you saw this out of context, I'm destroying a reef somewhere in Indonesia, like, and he used it as, look at this guy, he's destroying reefs, and then he panned back, and it was just me and my tank to prove a point, like, we do know what we're doing in the hobby, we can grow corals like this, just relax a little bit on what, you know, it's, so this is a monster piece. I think I'm going to fast forward through this one, too, but I do try to lift this up, and then I really didn't plan ahead, and I didn't know where to put it. once I did have it dislodged. But they say things are lighter underwater. They are, but not by a whole lot. This was massive. But I think I'll maybe cruise through this. So again, it's just going back to the not being complacent with your tank and not accepting. And there's a whole story of this tank. So some of the staff, you can sweat underwater. Just that was, my brow was sweating there. So now I've got the attention of all the staff, and Laura's out there and they're videoing. And Laura wants me to, she's trying to motion to somebody because she wants me to hold this coral above my head like the Lion King for a photo op. And everybody's like, I think maybe you should just leave him alone. He looks kind of busy. And Laura's like, no, it's fine. And so there's the knock on the window. But she got Maggie, one of the staff, to do the dirty work. She's like, tell Joe to lift, like, so there's this, and I'm like, I don't have enough on my plate right now. Oh, and I'm underwater. Like, like I'm trying to breathe underwater here. So I'm trying to get this thing over my head. Yes, absolutely. And I got it. Okay, get the photo. I don't got it. I'm going down. Yeah, so the audio here is really funny is if there's 10 people outside the tank and there's 9 of them going, oh my God, And there's one person laughing hysterically. Anybody want to guess who that one person laughing hysterically was? My lovely fiance. So and you can see the amount of detritus coming out of this, out of here. So again, this is going back towards. So I'm like, no, I'm done. So I almost destroyed almost all my excavating and carving that I did by it. So that's that. So there it is when it was too large and too bulky. That's after the first dive. That's after the second dive. You can see everything has been lowered down. Again, now there's better water flow. The lighting is getting to where you want it. The fish are happier. There's water flow. I was able to carve some tunnels and caves through the old coral skeleton. And then it grows back in. That's what it does. And again, it's that never-ending chess match of maneuvering. So fish management, again, this is, again, going back to long-term care and avoiding old tank syndrome that doesn't exist. So how do you get fish out of a 20,000-gallon tank? One of the methods is using floating pellets and targeting the fish that you're trying to get. So there was a big tang in the tank that I said, okay, he could have lived his entire life in the tank and that would be fine. So the tang, I got the pellet. You're going to see him coming in from the top right in a second here. That's my target right there. Here's my fish. So we're going to do a little slow motion here. So he could have stayed in the tank, but part of the thing was happening also was he was getting so big, he was throwing the proportions of the tank off because you thought, like, your coral was big, and then this monster fish just swims by and shadows it and blocks it out. Plus the food demand, this guy would eat a lot of food because he's a big animal. And I could have a lot more anthias or smaller fish in the tank with the same bio load. So there's my tang. That's playing a little slower than normal right now. So now I'm like, okay, and again, I have my lovely assistant there, and I'm wearing really heavy duty gloves in this picture because my other work gloves were a little bit thinner on a previous tang that I got out. They're called surgeon fish for a reason. They have an incredibly sharp scalpel spine at the base of their tail. And my other work gloves, which were lighter weight, he sliced right through it and split my finger wide open. So they're called surgeon fish for a reason. So of course, I have my trophy, I have my fish. You need that fisherman photo. Like, I've got my fish. And I didn't catch any other fish in that net. That was one of my most proud. So I have my lovely assistant, I'm holding the fish. Wait, I'm getting the shot, Laura's snapping away, everything's good. It's a big, strong fish, though. It's very strong. And that's... thank you. That's me dropping in. And it's a good thing we don't have the audio on right now because I let the expletives fly. You're going to see the splash here. And I couldn't believe it. But I caught him 4 hours later. So not the smartest fish. So he now resides in the shark tank. So again, this comes back to managing your fish. And also learn what fish you're getting long term. Like, this is how big they get. And like Live Aquarium, they're getting really good. They've been good for really describing, like, this is the fish, this is how big they get. Be wary of what fish, because our public aquariums are a limited resource. We can only take in so many animals. So again, you can imagine how much this fish eats, and what goes in one end comes out the other, and you have to deal with that. So he's out, and that now is giving me opportunities for getting back into a lot of my smaller fishes, my wrasses, antheas, cardinals, things like that. So it's been a lot of fun getting back into these guys. It's been fun. So, that's a tank. So I like that. And you get to see some natural behaviors now. This is when the green chromis first went in with some of the other smaller fish. So you can imagine it's a little overwhelming as the new guy on the block to go into the tank. So they probably won't keep this behavior as tight as they're doing it right now. But this is what you see on the reef. Like, okay, I'm going to go hide in that acropora now. And so again, seeing some of these natural behaviors going on in a system is very enjoyable. Keeping things, over time, like I said, what you did in the beginning and what you did what you're doing now versus the future. Here's three fine young men working in the summer, keeping the fingerprints off the tank. But, you know, they grow into this. And, like, if I maintained my kids the same now as I did when they were, like, they'd starve to death. I mean, the amount of food these guys eat is phenomenal compared to when they were younger. Same thing with your tanks. You got to constantly adjust what's happening, the demands on food, the demands on water changes, the demands on calcium. Your corals are getting bigger. You always have to stay on top of the additions. Every bottle comes with a clue on how much to dose per gallon, but there's interpretation there. If your tank has more coral than water, you need to really increase those dosage rates. So adjust your feeds, dosing, lighting, everything as your corals grow. Just another thing about old tanks also is sometimes there's no reason to allow them to look ugly. This is a public aquarium. We have company coming every day. This is sanding and buffing out all the scratches. So this is the acrylic panel sanded down. The left side has the next grade of sand, basically sandpaper. So the right side, you see the progression where you're buffing it out and you're bringing it back to a nice new piece of coral, a nice new piece of acrylic. So this is the finished side here. So I have a new tank again. So just another thing about old tanks, you should take care of them. The best way to do it is to get somebody else to do it for you. The novelty wore off really quickly. Laura did it for one night and said, that's really swell. But it's a lot of hard work to do it. Diving underwater and taking care of them underwater too, because you're going to scratch the glass and you're going to scratch the acrylics and with your cleaning poles, and fish have big teeth and stuff like that. So you use pneumatic sanders underwater to polish it out. And so again, avoiding the old looking tank syndrome. How about that? Balancing your fish, balancing your animals. Because my fish choices, I can't really have cleaner shrimp, things like that in the tank, but I do have cleaner wrasses that are a mated pair, and they pretty much spawn every night. Now, I'm not recommending cleaner wrasses for a lot of different or smaller tanks, but cleaner shrimp maybe, things like that. This is like going for a massage. You're trying to eliminate stress in your system. You're trying to eliminate stress to your fish. Just like us, if we're really stressed, we get sicker easier. Minimizing the stress. Fishes, that mucus coat that fish have, that's their main defense. They're sloughing mucus constantly. So if a parasite lands on them, that mucus coat, they're not getting to the skin. They're getting on that mucus coat and they're sloughing it off. So if your fish are stressed and not being fed well, they can't generate that mucus coat, things like that. So it's important to make sure your fish are happy and healthy. Staying ahead of cleaning your protein skimmers is very important. Again, you get lazy, you get complacent, all these things add up. And by themselves, they may not be that big a thing, but then you get this perfect storm of X, Y, and Z adding up and then kaboom. And then you're like, I don't know why that happened. Just even cleaning the air lines coming out of your protein skimmers. They build up muck over time, they restrict the flow, and then your protein skimmer efficiency drops dramatically because your hoses are not allowing that airflow. And then I think of my arteries when I see that. I'm like, oh man, I better get my blood test. Because that's just like, wow, I can see how much this restricts the flow of my, it's like, so yeah, arteries, you don't want restrictions of flow. Oh, we forgot to do the video of the Wandel. But I had the Wandel Sanjay thing, so. And again, just cleaning the protein skimmers to a big level of getting the bioballs out. This is a protein skimmer that I built for the reef tank. It's 500 gallons, it handles about 200 gallons per minute. And this day kind of sucked, this was a bad day. I'm still smiling, but yeah, that was after many years of operation and I made a mistake and I cracked one of the windows in the protein skimmer, so I had to go in and repair it. But yeah, not a good day. Parasite misidentification and misdiagnosis and coral deaths, you know, acro-eating flatworms. I know we were suffering from these guys back in the early 90s. We just weren't looking close enough to see what was happening, and there's a whole story there. But now, these were new to science. So that was a very exciting thing for a number of people. And so really looking at your corals, trying to figure out what's happening and why they're not doing well is really important. So acro-eating flatworms, you can flush them off. So in my tank, when you have 20,000 gallons, you're not pulling corals out and treating them elsewhere. So I flush them out with the, I just go in with a garden hose, the fresh water, and Fernando over here at Scripps, we did some work, and he was studying them, and he was taking little coral fragments and flushing them with RO water to get the flatworms to come off so they could study them intact, because they're really delicate. And that got me thinking, I could maybe blow them off in my reef tank. And I do with a freshwater hose. And there's a whole story here that I'm happy to share over a beer or two. But in the urgency of time, I'm going to just go past it. So you can get ahead of them. You become the natural predator of those flatworms. Obviously, they're being eaten in the wild by something. So I became the predator. I got ahead of their reproduction curve. My acropores, they can handle a small population of these flatworms. They can't handle a lot of them. So I blow them off with this freshwater hose. And this is when the staff thinks I've completely lost my mind, because I'm in my tank watering my corals. And they're like, Joe needs a vacation. He's, because it is, it's a garden hose. And the fish love to eat them once they're off the corals. But this, this is how I still truly feel about them. I don't like them, but I'm beating them, and I've won. So that's a good thing. Turning your tank on, turning lights on at night is a really good way of finding out where your predators are. A lot of the bad guys come out at night, so going down there with a red flashlight, something like that, or just turn the lights on. You never know what you're gonna find middle of the night. You turn your lights on your tank. You just never know, never know. So, we were talking with Sanjay earlier, and he was pulling some corals out of his tank to make room for new corals from MACNA. And I said, that's a good idea. Let me just, look how many frags I could now place where that coral was, right? That's pretty impressive. So again, maintaining flow is very important. Removing detritus. Detritus buildup in a tank is just like, that's the long-term slow death sentence of allowing detritus to accumulate in a system. So again, big tank, big turkey baster. Music for this, please, if we could. So this is a forgotten tank at the reef, because we talk so much about the, I'm sorry. Let me go back. I goofed that one up. Yeah, there we go. So this is a 2,400-gallon clownfish anemone tank at the aquarium that I maintain. So it's 9 feet by 6 feet by 6 feet. Filled with a bunch of rose bubble tip anemones, and I was working on some of the filtration, had everything off, and so this is, you know, a droopy tank, which kind of shows. So how do you get rid of stagnant water? Just a show of hands. Who knows what sea swirls are and who uses them? Yeah, it's kind of a little bit of a forgotten technology, and I think what's really exciting about it now was, because they used to be with a lot of closed loops, and closed loops were power hogs and electricity. But you have incredibly efficient DC pumps coming out now, like the Abyss pumps and things that make closed loops a very attractive option again. So sea swirls, they rotate at a 90 degree angle. And so here's the tank. So this tank is using 3 1-inch sea swirls for the flow. So again, this is 2,400 gallons, 9 foot by 6 foot by 6 foot. There's one fixed return line and 3 1-inch sea swirls. And that's the flow that you're getting in this system. So again, flow is life. This is a half horsepower propeller unit that's in the reef tank that I'll use for storming the tank. You can see the wave coming across from it. The wave is propagating across. You're gonna see the gorgonia start moving. You're gonna see those anemones start to move. And with that, you're just gonna see a lot of detritus and stuff coming out of it. Laura, if you're looking for your phone, it's up here. That's my girl. I know that look. So now these anemones, this is 25 feet away from that pump, just for putting it in perspective on flow. So I call this storming the tank. And you can do this on any size tank. Get in there and throw a bunch of extra flow on your tank beyond what's normally there to get that detritus lifted so your mechanical filters and your protein skimmers can pull it out. All kinds of great products now on the market. You know, the hobby caught on to how efficient prop units are. And because again, we have electric bills to pay and things like that. So again, having some of these on your tanks are great. And then maybe having one more that you just throw on once in a while just to really crank up the tank. This is a quick little video of a max spec gyre and the wattage you see with the speed, and you'll see the flow increasing. And again, just having, you can almost not give them too much flow, a lot of these corals and anemones, especially when you look at the ranges where they come from. So I can't emphasize the flow part enough, and part of that comes back to also your size of your corals, right? Picture this tank in another year when those corals are getting bigger, that same flow is not gonna do the same thing. So how to get bigger flow in a bigger tank? Well, you get Sanjay. And he's holding a hydro wizard here, and you can see it's in front of his home tank there. He was the sales rep and front man for sales weren't that good, so we changed the modeling a little bit, and sales went up. So sorry, Sanjay. Sanjay's out. So this is a hydro wizard pump, which is a large propeller driven pump. And Abiz is coming out with one now, which I'm really excited about. Alex was at the aquarium, and we shared a few beers, and we were playing with his prototype of his propeller unit. And I don't know whether one's here at the show, but definitely check out the Abiz pumps. And so you're gonna have an average flow of your system, and what flow, and then you wanna be able to adjust that. So you can adjust the volume of this flow. But this thing will move about 50,000 gallons an hour using 348 watts. This is a surge mech, this is it in a surge mode. So that's 20,000 gallons of oscillation there, which is really impressive when you think about these propeller units can develop that much. So here it is, left side, kind of the average flow, my daily kind of flow. And then we're gonna increase here a little bit in a second. So here's a little bit of a top view, purple Milka up top here. You'll see that coming out of the water in the when the surge is cranking. So it's a good 3 to 4 inch surge there. And again, I don't keep it like this all the time, but I'll run it for a few hours, a couple of times a week, just to really, again, get that stuff moving, get that detritus out of your system. So you can see the anemones rocking out there. So again, you can see I'm kind of focused on flow. Cut through a few other things. Nutrient control, long-term. Nutrient control is a lecture upon itself. We could spend an entire lecture easily talking about nutrient control. I do use lanthanum chloride as a means of exporting phosphates. Pretty much any liquid lanthanum product that's, any liquid phosphate removing product that's out there is lanthanum based. So I just use one from a pool industry. And again, a lot more details on this, and I'm happy to talk to people about that. In the past, the bottle on the left said the Aquarist of the Year says don't use lanthanum chloride. I think that was the year Mr. Richard Ross winning. But there's a new guy in town, and the new and improved Aquarist of the Year says use lanthanum chloride. So you can see how much better looking I am now too. That's And Laura's happy. Look how Laura and my kids are smiling. Everybody's everything's improved. So it's awesome. Fosban, Julian came up with the Fosban back in 2002, I think was the first year I used it. And it's a GFO, granular ferric oxide, and it's originally designed for removing arsenic from drinking water. And they realized it was a valuable asset to have in an aquarium because it will also grab phosphate. So I use it for grabbing phosphate also. The bulk of my phosphate removal is from the lanthanum. Some of it's from the Fosban, but what I really like with the Fosban is, just think about it, if it's designed to remove arsenic, right, it's gonna grab what I call the unknown nasties from your system, stuff that's building up long-term over time. It's coming out of your food, it's coming out of maybe a rusty clamp somewhere, it's coming out of a lot of stuff. So removing those unknown nasties, the corals are oozing out, just crazy compounds. So there's a good chance this granular ferric oxide is going to grab it. So that was a really good idea Julian had, was using the Fosban. This was not a great idea. This it took me a long time to clean my glass. By the time I got to one end, it was dirty again on the other side. So we just kind of talked about this. But again, staying ahead of those organics and nasty things building up over time are going to give you that long-term success to avoid an old tank syndrome, which is a syndrome that doesn't exist, but you got to get off your ass, right? That's part of it. Vodka dosing, nutrient control. Again, we're just going to skim through this, but this was an article on Reef Central. The column on the end there is, they only went up to a 1,000-gallon tank. So I had to multiply that column by 20. I don't know why they didn't go up to 20,000 on the chart, but you know, they didn't. So here's some dosing that was done. The red line are the nitrates. The green line is the vodka. So you can see as I increased the vodka dosing, the nitrates came down. And then I said, all right, what's the minimum amount of vodka that I can dose to my tank to still have the success that I want? Because the less vodka that's going in the tank can come to me. So, so it's like, okay, let's start diminishing the amount of vodka here. And you can see the nitrates were still coming down. And here's where Lars kicked in. And I didn't test for a while. My nitrates went back up again. And I started increasing the vodka again. And nitrates started to come back down again. So it does work. You have to be careful with it. Just like any chemical, the lanthanum you have to be careful with, vodka you have to be careful with, oxygen you have to be careful with. I can kill you with oxygen. So anything you dose, you have to be careful with. But this is real numbers, right? This is not just somebody saying I dose vodka and it works great. You want to see some numbers and statistics that back that up. And that's what that does. There's a whole variety of ways of dosing vodka. This is my preferred method of dosing the vodka. Don't do this during the day when the school kids are there. The teachers, they just get upset. Like, why is that man drinking in the tank? And it gets awkward. Talking to people, there's never not a reason to not include this slide. I don't care what lecture it is. I put this slide in. So you got Richard Ross, Charles Delbecq, Simon from the UK, and our Sanjay, our little Sanjay. But you know, just being here, going to conferences, you know, I can pretty much guarantee you every speaker that's here really enjoys talking. So definitely feel that, you know, that we're approachable and we like to talk about these things. But talk to people that really know what they're doing and what they're saying. All right, we're 41 minutes in. So lighting, evolutions of lighting, again, staying ahead of the curve on stuff. About 25,000 watts of light above this tank. So when your significant other complains about your electric bill, just point them to me, and that'll take the pressure off of you. Because my electric bill this month at the aquarium, the facility, not just the tank, was $84,000 for the month. So we're about $1 million a year in utilities. So you can talk to your spouse about your electric bill and be like, at least I'm no Joe, and it takes the pressure off of you. So looking towards LEDs, now they're making LEDs that are big enough. They've got enough backbone to handle my tank. So here's a max spec 14K. This is the 300-watt version, which was one of their early prototypes. That's been running over 2.5 years now without incident. I just had a driver go bad on it, but it's about 10,000 hours, and that's kind of what that one was rated for. So there's a whole host of LEDs that are available. Here's an Orphic 300. And let's see. Yeah, and there's a Geissman 500 watt. So I also have, so here's some looking at some LEDs on the tank. I'm old school. I love my halides. LEDs are awesome. They grow a lot of corals. To my eye, they're still a little too crisp, a little too perfect. I like the tone and texture of a halide. I feel like the guys when CDs first came out, and all the vinyl guys were like, CDs suck, there's no tone, there's no texture. I feel that way a little bit about halides versus LEDs. But that said, if I were to do a big tank right now, again, it would be complete with the LEDs and the max spec LEDs. So they're definitely worth checking out. So maintaining fish long term.
But actually, I do want
to. So the Genacanthus angels here are starting to court right here. You'll see the male, he's going to flutter and he's going to strut his stuff. And he bumps under the female, and boom, that's it. So, and now he chases everybody else away because he doesn't want them to eat their eggs. So kind of long-term, and again, this is another whole lecture on coral, on fish spawning and rearing and things like that. So, but if your system is happy and healthy, if they have, you know you're doing good when they can then invest the energies into reproduction and they're not just in survival mode. So what we do is we'll put a plankton net in the tank, collect the larvae and the eggs overnight. This was the initial setup, and I thought, wow, I'm just going to have so many great things in the morning. I'm so good. I'm a professional, and I'm a curator, and this is going to be awesome. And I come in the morning, and the freaking net's on the ground and broke some corals, and that was a bit humbling. So what do you do, you know, anytime a problem comes up? Sometimes it's just good to throw money at stuff, right? So got a sponsor, and now it's but I can only leave the net in the tank for 4 hours. So here's an antheus. It's the first antheus ever raised in captivity from spawning. That was done by this fine young man, Noel, who's one of our aquarists who's been working under Todd Gardner, who will be speaking, I believe, on Sunday about some very exciting stuff. So wake up early and see Todd's talk on Sunday. So this is the first antheus ever done in captivity anywhere. So we're collecting a lot of eggs, and we're really pushing the envelope, which is very exciting. Where are we going to now? So we grow a lot of corals. What do we do with all those corals? So just a little plug here for Reef Gen. And so with captive bred corals, so definitely check us out. And there's some of the contact for us. Other cool things that happen in my tank, engagements, things like that. She actually said yes, so that was pretty cool. So this was an entire presentation when I first started giving lectures back in 1991, talking about live rock, circulation, lighting, protein skimming, chemical supplementation. This was all new. And there's a picture. This is Julian right here. He had a lot more hair, and I had like really big, crazy glasses and a yellow dive watch. But this was a reef tank that I had back in. I started this one in 1989. And it's still one of my favorite reef tanks. So it's amazing how far the hobby has come. So you're talking to these people, trying to find out how do you avoid this old tank syndrome? How do you avoid these LARs? And they didn't want their identifications known. So I did my best to kind of try and hide. It was weird, they didn't want, they wanted to give their opinions on stuff. And you're gonna see pretty much a common thread through all of these. A lot of it's nutrient control, exporting. Here's Sitch Marl. That one's a funny one. Of course, he's having fun with Jake. And then also be careful about chasing perfect numbers, right? If your tank is doing well, you do want to maintain and watch things, but not chasing numbers also, and not pushing that envelope, because you push the envelope in certain areas, that perfect storm comes up, and if your nitrates were high, and nitrates are way overrated, don't get me started on nitrates. My tank runs usually around 30 parts per million, so nitrates are easy to blame for problems, because it's easy to test for. So here's Con Jobs. So again, and talk about meticulous, this guy. I mean, he rinses his food in RO water. Like it just, yeah, that's so far. But you see his systems and it's mind-boggling. For him, John does awesome. Oh, I said I slipped. Sorry, never mind. This guy. So again, flow, rock work, getting rid of that detritus. So I just asked these guys, give me your top five ways of keeping your tank successful long-term. And again, you're just going to see anybody ever go down to SeaWorld Orlando, be sure to check out the reef tank down there. It's 12,000 gallons of beautiful, beautiful corals. I go there and I say, wow, those corals are huge. So those are huge corals down there. There's Dandy Ronowitz. And again, you're seeing a common thread here of he threw in a good one at the end there, just a sacrificial. So maybe to Sanjay. Because you don't want to get Sanjay'd, so. So again, you're going to see the kind of the same thing. If I'm going too fast through these, let me know. But Koji Apparata. Oddly, he mentioned tri. It was weird. I don't know why he mentioned that, but he said. So, but it is interesting to have all these new testings like Triton available that can test for even some of those unwanted nasties that we couldn't test for in the past. So very exciting to have those tools available to us. Sabatark, I think he's from like Norway. I'm not sure. So again, common thread. Bifus, I love his first one there. Just break your tank every 2 years, and then you don't have to worry about it getting old. So you don't have to avoid the old tank syndrome just by having your tank leak. Pike Muleta, again, you're going to see same thing of staying ahead of, just trying to stay ahead of everything. This guy, same thing. Detritus. And that leaves us with this guy. I didn't know how to, so I just gave up and just said, it's Kevin Cohen. Like, he could, it's Kevin Cohen. So no deep sand bed. Clean equipment on a consistent schedule. Don't deviate from water change schedule. Siphon detritus from everywhere. Everywhere. That's the key. Everywhere. And overgrowth of soft corals and water changes. So you stop changing your water. You have all these things all the things that you should have been doing. And then you jump back in full speed ahead with rapid changes. You're going to make huge improvements all at once kind of thing. And that's a big shock to the system. And the remaining corals, despite all your hard work, which are technically improvements, your lingering corals then die. You've gone too much too fast, right? You get in maintenance mode. You're like, oh my God, I haven't changed the bulbs in a while. And I won't be able to say that too much longer because it's LEDs, right? But if you didn't change your bulbs or you change, and then you change your carbon the same day you put new bulbs on, the carbon, your water clarity is going to go up. It's going to absorb all those organics in the water. It's going to increase the light penetration and then new bulbs on top of that. So be careful about when you get back into the game, making which improvements and where. Record keeping is very important. I check temperature and pH every day on the system, and then every once in a while, a couple times a month, I'll do alkalinity and things like that. But I have quite a list of handwritten. I have joined this century for monitoring, so that is a nice thing to have. I write on my fixtures, like when I change the bulbs, because I lose track of things, and if I have the dates written in a book, I'm gonna forget to check the book. So as I'm walking by my tank, I'm like, oh my gosh, it's been a year since I changed that bulb or whatever. So whatever you can do to make your schedule and your reminders better, just do it, and that works out very well. So there are some tanks that don't accept certain corals, and tanks that use to house certain corals can no longer keep them. So for me, I couldn't keep Seriatopora, bird's nest, in my tank for 14 years. I couldn't keep it on any system that was attached to that system. We'd grow it behind the scenes. ReefGen had it growing out of their tanks, beating it back. My tank would not accept it. And it why? But after 14 years, what was the exact reason why I was able now to grow it? Well, I'm going to give a little hint into what I think was the possibility. But there are just certain tanks that just don't allow certain corals to grow. I don't know what it is, but we will talk about the colors of my tank. If people haven't seen my tank in the last 2 years, I get a lot of visitors that are talking about the color of the tank, and good friend Bob Stark over at ESV, we've been working on this transition elements, and I do see a huge difference in the tank as far as colors, durability of the corals. There's just other layers of coloration. So Bob is at the conference here. I think he has stuff sitting right in front of me here, and also has some product over at Champion Table. So again, if you know me, I don't endorse, I don't get behind product. If I find something that I know works, like the Fosban or certain light fixture, I want that information out there for you guys to use. So I really recommend looking into what ESV transition elements can do for you, whether you have, and there's two formulations, one high nitrate, if you have higher nitrates, and one lower nitrates. So another thing about getting back into your reef tank and keeping it going long term is it's got to be interesting to you. My reef tank is 16 years old. I'm in a 16-year relationship with this tank. I got to, you know, we got to spice it up once in a while, keep it interesting. So do something to reignite your passion with the tank. Re-aquascape it. A lot of you don't realize how much coral you've grown in your tank and how it's really just filled in things and how much fun you'll have enjoying getting in there, ripping it apart, small sections at a time, and re-aquascaping things. You'll be amazed. So anything you can do to spice up your reef tank is, you know, anything, just whatever it takes. So here we are. It's a touching end to my talk. It's just really just staying ahead of that coral. That's your competitor in your chess game, and they're just looking to outmaneuver you, and you have to do everything you can just to stay in that game. You're never going to win. Corals will always humble you at some point. That's part of the territory. So I think I'm at 55 minutes, which is I think pretty damn good for me. I do have a Acropora stuber story, but I think I will pass on that. But ask me about that one over a beer. Thank you again to Jeff and everybody else. And if you have any questions.